God bless you, saints. We greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like to welcome all those that are present and those that are joining us on virtual networks. We're thankful for this opportunity that we can gather together in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in this day and age. We know that it's the end time and that times like these are scarce, but we're thankful for when we can come and feed off of the fresh carcass. I'd like to just mention that Pastor Blessing is away with his family. He's going to be with the family in Limpopo. It is his father's birthday, so we'd like to wish our elder a very happy birthday. We wish you more of Jesus and your walk with Christ, maybe a closer one, and may you have your best year yet. We'd like to, if you can turn with me to Psalm 11, I'd just like to read a portion of scripture. When you have found it, it reads as follows. In the Lord put I my trust. How say ye, my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? For lo, the wicked bend their bow, and they make ready their arrow upon the string, that they may privily shoot at the upright in heart. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try the children of men. The Lord trieth the righteous, but the wicked and him that loveth violence, his soul hateth. Upon the wicked shall he rain snares, fire, brimstone, and an horrible tempest. This shall be the portion of their cup. For the righteous Lord loveth righteousness, and his countenance doth behold the upright. This morning we have Brother Luke with us. We would like to welcome Brother Luke to the pulpit to preach whatever the Lord has laid upon his heart. Welcome, brother.
Shalom, saints. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It is so wonderful to come together as we are growing closer unto the end of time. So I also greet those who are also on the virtual network. May God richly bless you. May we stand and turn our Bibles to Luke 21, and then we start at verse 20. It says, "And when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the dissolution thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter therein. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled." So there are certain signs which we have to see for you to get out of Jerusalem. And today there are certain things which we have to see and not, so that you get out of this situation, this evil world that we are living in. Let's go again to Luke 21:34. We'll still continue. "And take heed to yourself, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day cometh upon you unawares. For as a snare it come on all them that dwell in the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man." So here I titled the escape. From here we're saying that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things. So there should be an escape. And I've titled this preaching, The Great Escape. Let's pray. Amen. Oh Heavenly Father, I come, Lord, unto you this morning. Father, as we have gathered, Lord, physically here, Lord, may you be with us. Yes. And there are those, Lord, we have joined in from different parts of the world, Lord.
Yes.
May you be with them as well. And there are those who are going to watch even later, Lord.
Amen.
May you be with them, Lord. As we look at this world, Lord, that there is no more time, Lord.
Amen.
What are the things, Lord, that we need not to see?
Yes.
What are the things, Lord, that we have to correct? And Lord, as we pray, Lord, for your faith, for you have asked, would you find faith, Lord, when you cometh? I thank you, Lord, for this time. May you, Lord, influence me.
Yes.
May you guide me, not only me, but also the hearers, Lord. May you touch each and every person, Lord.
Amen.
In Jesus Christ's name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, saints. As we can see, you can take your seats. As you can see, there is an escape which has to happen.
Amen.
And you cannot escape from a good thing. You can only escape from danger, from judgment, to a place of safety.
Yes.
So, when we are here, Jesus Christ is giving them signs that when you shall see the encompassing of Jerusalem, that was to them. But to us, what is it? There is an encompassing as well, which has to happen. And we need to look at this. When you look at the world events, the encompassing has already started for us as Gentiles. So there are certain things which we have to look and we have to gain ourselves. And it says, do not even go back when you see these things. Do not even try to go back and take whatever you have. You just have to run. You just have to escape.
Mm.
So there are three things today which we have to look at, which we have to escape from. There is tribulation, which is if you are alive, you need to escape tribulation.
Mm, amen.
And if you happen to die, you need to escape hell.
Yes.
Amen.
And at the end of everything, you have to escape the second death.
Mm.
Because these are the things of judgment. If you are still alive at that time, there is tribulation to come. And if you die now, you go to hell. It's another tribulation, but you are dead.
Mm.
So escaping tribulation is through rapture.
Mm.
Escaping hell is to go to heaven.
Amen.
And you have to be in the millennium for you to escape the second death.
Wow. Amen.
So when we look at tribulation, let's go to Revelation 9, verse 1 to 6. What we have to note here about tribulation, it's torment.
Mm.
Revelation 9, verse 1 to 6. And the fifth angel sounded and saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth. And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have got power. So these locusts have got power like locusts, like scorpions. If you want to know how pain is, ask a person who have had a scorpion bite. It's very, very, very painful. And it was commanded them that they should not eat the grass of the earth, neither the green thing, neither any tree. Listen to this. These locusts have to feed, but they are told they should not eat what? The green grass. Locust eats grass.
Mm.
Locust eats green things.
Mm.
Locust eats trees.
Yeah.
What are they going to eat?
Amen.
But only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads.
Mm.
So here their food is going to be men, evil men who are going to be on the earth. So your flesh would be food for these locusts, the word says so. And to them it was given that they should not kill them. So the eating of it is not going to kill you.
Yeah.
But that they should be tormented 5 months. So it's a tormentation of being beaten with scorpions without dying. That is the example of it. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he struck at the man. So this is them. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it.
Yeah.
Mm.
They shall desire to die, and the death shall flee from them. So you cannot even die. So it's now being tormented when you are alive. Let's go to 2 Peter 2 verse 4. So the first one, this is tribulation when you are alive. And we want to look at the tormentation in hell. Let's go to 2 Peter 2 verse 4.
Amen.
2 Peter 2 verse 4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. So even the angels which sinned were what? Were delivered in chains of darkness, right? To be reserved unto judgment. So hell, it's a place of waiting for judgment.
Mm.
Yeah.
But you have lost your conscious.
Mm-hmm.
Tribulation, you are waiting for judgment. Mm-hmm. But you have got conscious.
Sure.
No, you are alive and conscious.
Sure.
With the tribulation, you are alive and conscious. With the hell, you are dead, but you are still conscious.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to Luke 16 verse 23. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. So two people died here.
Mm-hmm.
And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. So even in hell he could lift up his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And he was in torments. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. So even there, he's still trying to what? To repent, but he's in hell. Even during the time of tribulation, they will try to repent, but they are already in tribulation. There's already a great divide which has happened because the bride has already left. So it's the same thing.
Sure. Amen.
And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water. When you are here, he still thinks that Lazarus is a person you can send anytime.
Yeah.
And this shows that he's still conscious and he still can see that this is Lazarus.
Mm.
He still can know Lazarus. And his torment here, it's saying he just wants a dip of a finger in water and drop, one drop. Can you imagine that much torment for you to want only one drop of water? This is
Amen.
The torment of hell. You are dead, but you are conscious. And he said, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus. Verse 25. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received the good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot. So you cannot pass, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee, Father, therefore, that thou would send him to my father's house. So he's asking for the resurrection of Lazarus. For I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. So he wants Lazarus to be resurrected, so that he can go and testify to his brothers, so that they should not come to that place. And Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent.
Mm-hmm.
So this is his belief, that if someone is resurrected, they are going to repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead.
Amen.
So as time goes on, this is the time of Abraham. There was Lazarus whom this wanted to rise. In time of Jesus Christ, another Lazarus was risen from the dead. Did they listen to him? Or they sought to even persecute him because he had to testify that Jesus was Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So even Jesus Christ arose. Did they believe to him? So unbelief has nothing to do with what you see. It has all to do with whether you have got faith. Even if they see that this is a crippled, this is a blind, this is a man who have been resurrected from the dead, they are not going to believe. Look at all how they opposed Brother Branham. They saw that. They saw the eyes being created. They saw those who were pronounced dead coming to life.
Amen.
They saw those who had all those diseases, but did they believe him? They always find a point of them not to believe. They always find something. So it has nothing to do with what you can see, but it's all to do with what is it that you can believe through your heart.
Amen.
So tribulation, but why can't they die? Remember here in Revelation 9 verse 6, it said they cannot die. Because, remember, those who are in tribulation, the bride is already taken off.
That's right.
And there's a promise to the bride, which God has made to the bride. There is a new condition, because the bride is now with Jesus Christ, is with God. In Revelation 21 verse 4, let's look at what happened to death, because they are seeking death. Let's go to Revelation 21 verse 4. He said, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, who? The bride. And there shall be no more death.
Mm.
So here, because there's a condition to the bride, there they've been said it's no more. And them, they are still alive in tribulation. So this is what has happened to death. It cannot be there again. Let's go to Revelation 20 verse 14. He says, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. So, this is the second death, not of anything, it's of death itself and hell. So, death and hell are no longer existing. So, even in that time of torment, if they want to die, they cannot die because death no longer exists. They are just waiting for judgment. Let's go to, for those with the quotation, let's go to quote number one. It says here, from and no, it is not, 1965. And he stretched forth his rod at the command of God and said, let frogs come up and cover the earth. And the frogs come till they heaped up in piles. Stink was everywhere, the stinking of frogs. This is in Pharaoh's time. Maybe 40 feet high. 40 feet high is 15 meters of frogs. This is during Pharaoh's time. It was 15 meters of frogs. And they were stinking. You know, those of you who have come across those frogs, how they stink. They were in the cupboard of Pharaoh. They were turned down the sheets and there were 500 frogs.
Sure.
Imagine 500 frogs where you want to be on your bed. There are 500 frogs under the sheets, under the bed, in the rugs, everywhere. There were frogs, frogs, frogs. Where did they come from? God, the Creator, is sovereign. What he says, he will do.
Amen.
So here, this is more. God did not say that, but he said that through Moses. It's Moses who said that. Even in this time, those prophecies which Brother Branham says, they are going to come to pass, and it will be. It is God. We said so. And he said there would be hideous sights upon the earth. Locusts with hair like women. So this is now, Brother Branham is now putting it up to this time.
Yeah.
The frogs of Pharaoh are like this time. Long hair to haunt them women that cut their hair.
Sure.
Sisters. Teeth like lions. Stingers in their tails like scorpions. They will torment men for months. Just wait till we get to open the plugs and seals. Them seven thunders. Watch what takes place. Oh, brother, you better get to Goshen. So this is the escape again. You have to get to the Goshen. You have to be raptured. While they still time, get together, don't pay attention to this outside world. So you look at this, this was stipulation for Pharaoh. He had to go through these frogs and all this. And at the end, what happened? At his death, his second death, he died in the sea.
That's right.
Mm. Amen.
So there's always tribulation before. Before your final death.
Amen.
Before judgment. Revelations 2. Let's go to Revelations 2, verse 11.
Amen.
Mm. Revelation 2. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Amen.
He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. So this is our escape. He that has what an ear, let him hear what he said. And you shall not be hurt of the second death. So this is what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. The second death will not have power to the rapture, whether you are asleep or you have been raptured. And at the end, we know both who are asleep and those who are going to be alive, they are all going to be raptured and taken to Goshen so that they can escape this. They can escape the second death.
Mm-hmm.
So, there is the first resurrection, which is of life.
Yes.
This is to the bride. And then there is a second resurrection, which is of those in damnation. If we go to Revelation 21, verse 8. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So these ones, after they are in hell, they've been released, and then torment, they've been released, they're also going to something which is even much more worse, because at that place even death cannot exist. It's a place for people to escape. Sorry, there's quite a number of scriptures which I'm going to go through, if you can be patient with me, so that as I'm building here, let's go to Matthew 28, verse 30. I always want to look at the scripture so that some of these thoughts, by the time I get to them, you would have seen the foundation of it. And there's no foundation which is better than the scripture, the word, and the quotations. Let's start from Matthew 23, verse 30. 23. And say, if we had been in the days of our fathers, these are the Pharisees and scribes. He said, and say, so here they are saying to Jesus Christ, if we had been in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. So they are distancing themselves from what their fathers did unto the prophets, to say, if that time we were there, we were not going to do the what? The same thing. We were not going to refuse the scriptures. We were not going to fight against the quotations. We were not going to add nor subtract. Wherefore, you be witness unto yourself. This is Jesus now replying them, that that you are the children of them which killed the prophets. So Jesus Christ is saying, I'm going to show you that you are going to witness to yourself that you are the children of your fathers. Fill you up then the measure of your father. So even yourself, you are going to fill the same measure of what your father did. Ye serpents, he's already addressed them. Ye generations of vipers, how can you escape the damnation of hell? So this is that damnation of hell. Wherefore, behold, I send unto you prophets and wise men and scribes, and some of them you shall kill and crucify. Did they do that?
Yes.
They filled their...
That's right.
Yes, they filled their measures. And some of them you shall scourge in your synagogue and persecute them from city to city. So, you see at this time, even us brothers, in the time of Noah, which side were you going to be found?
Sure.
Most of the time we think we would have been found with Noah. It's not easy.
Mm.
We have to look at it today, whether you were going to be with Noah or you were going to be outside.
Amen.
In the days of Lot, were you going to be found with those who were giving Lot hard time? Or you were going to be found with Lot? or you are going to be found with Abraham. So Abraham, we know, he represents the rapture.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's the same thing in the days of Jesus Christ. Were you going to be with him, or you are going to shout, let's crucify him? In the days of Peter and Paul, were you going to be found where? Were you going to stone them, or you are going to be part of the stoned?
Yeah.
And in the days of William Branham, we have to see it. Were you going to stand with him?
Yes.
Or you were going to oppose him?
Oh, no.
And today, which side are you on? This is what we have to look at. So there are certain things which we have to look at, believers. Today, let's just look at the small things of today. I'm talking about today, as in 2021. We have heard the message from a prophet. There's a lot of things which have happened.
Amen.
He had had 1933 visions, 7 visions. 5 of them passed when he was alive. The other one today, some they say it is that they are correct. Yeah. Some they still say maybe it's not. They are still correct because there is a lot of things they said, president, vice president, and all that. But there is a message behind that.
Amen.
It's building to something.
Amen.
So those who are saying it has passed of the vice president, yes, it has passed. But there are those who are saying, yes, it's vice president, but it's supposed to be president. It has passed. There are those who say she was supposed to be wearing purple.
Yeah.
It's there, but it's part of the same vision. And God did it purposely.
Yeah.
If you look at the other visions, 5 visions, they were straight. You could not argue about Hitler, about Mussolini, about women's dressing. But when it comes to this, because he knew the prophet is not going to be there even to explain what the prophet say.
Yeah.
But there is a spirit in you that know, when you see this, this is part of the encompassing of Jerusalem.
Hallelujah.
Yourself, don't focus on that. Just look at the word.
Yes.
Where are you today?
Amen.
It's supposed to shape you, brothers.
Amen.
When I saw that which happened and which was shared, for me, whichever way, I believe it's part and parcel. When I read, there is purple dress. Is there, she's wearing a purple dress.
Yeah.
There is that one of vice president. She's there as the vice president. Yes, some would say, we are waiting for what? We are waiting for the president.
Exactly.
It's still fine, but with that portion which we have seen, which we can relate to in the quotations, that has to shake you. When we look at the election of the second Catholic president, you will see what happened in 1960 at the election of Kennedy. It's the same thing which happened at the election of Joe Biden. The same things which they were complaining for Nixon, how the elections were rigged. And me, I believe the elections were rigged because I was reading the scriptures. I was reading the quotations. And if Brother Branham said the first one came by machines which were rigged, how can the second one not have the same thing?
That's right.
And how would it even link it? That the same complaints which they are having today are the same complaints of 60 years ago.
Mm.
So for me, I just looked at it. There is no time, brothers and sisters.
Mm.
Let's go to quote, the second quote. It says, I just want to look at the point at certain things whereby us as believers, we sort of add or we sort of subtract or we put our human mind in something. And in so trying to do, in so trying to help God in the righteousness of men, in the righteousness of believers, we end up erring.
Sure.
The Bible says, do not add nor subtract.
Yes. Yes.
If it said this, it is that.
Amen.
If it said here a little, do not add for it to be more.
Yes.
If it said more, do not make it little.
Yes.
Just say as it is. So I want to give an example.
Yeah.
This is one of the quotations which I wanted to share with brothers. And it's quotation number 2. It's coming from the presence of God and recognized.
Amen.
So, it's no longer working from this side. So, I think maybe I have to switch it off. So it says here, in the presence of God unrecognized, it says, when no man should ever kiss a woman till he is married to her.
Yes.
The male and female glands crossing, let it be wherever it may be, it's wrong. It's potentially a sex act.
Mm-hmm.
So the kissing of a male and a female, it's a potential sex act. It's part of a sex act. Male and female glands touch. It's a sex act.
Amen.
Right. And it's made. A man kiss a man in the mouth. It's happening. It would make him vomit. A real man would what? Vomit. A woman and a woman. Why is it different? It's a sex act.
Amen.
Potentially, that's right. A type of kissing his bride, of a type of Christ kissing his bride.
Amen.
See, you should never do that.
Amen.
But look at it today. All these movies and things. So you see, he's talking about the movies and things and one big conglomeration of kissing and hugging. And it's absolutely almost public adultery.
Yeah.
It's almost pornography.
Come on now.
Sure.
The kissing which they are doing. It's almost, and here he's saying it's in movies. He did not talk about TV. Everywhere. And the people so blind, they don't see it.
Amen.
Right. Everything is in Sodom. Now, let me look at this. I want to give it as an example. For me, when I started to know believers, one thing which I knew was that they don't watch television.
Yeah.
That is the only thing. But is it good that you are known as not watching television? Where did it come from? And brothers, I have to say, when you look into it, there is a sort of an error in that. Why? Because Brother Branham is talking about movies here. When you look at people watching movies, yes, they put away the televisions. But because they did not preach against the movies, they did not preach against television programs, they did not preach against series and dramas. Those people, they let their... I was surprised some other time I visited a place of brothers. I was still new in the message and no television. And I've thrown away all my music, all my movies and everything. But I was surprised to see their children. They are there with laptops watching movies. Today, brothers, people are watching movies. Yes, there's nothing if you are watching a right movie, it's fine.
Amen.
Let's not talk about if you are watching something which is good for your religious edification, it's fine.
Amen.
But when in that movie, there are people kissing, potentially, you are watching pornography. And today it's even worse because they've got simulated sex acts. So you're already watching pornography.
Sure.
But it's not their fault. They were told to put away the televisions. But why did you not tell them that also these television programs, even though the Brother Branham was differentiating, because the devil is so cunning. People have got confidence. We don't have television. But they've got television programs.
Amen.
And movies are no longer movies whereby people go to the cinemas. They are now on Netflix.
Amen.
They are now on Showmax.
Come on now.
They are now on public broadcast. And if you look at the dramas, even the normal dramas which are acted here, what is it that they are putting in? Men kissing another man. Women kissing another man. What is it? They are desensitizing already. For the people to what? And also the devil. Let's go to Romans 1 verse 32. So that you understand that when you watch these things and you see a man and a woman kissing and there's a simulated sex act, let's go to Romans 1:32 so that you get to understand it.
Amen.
It says here, who knowing the judgment of God, we're talking about the judgment of God.
Yeah.
We've spoken about it, that they which commit such things are worthy of death.
Amen.
Not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. But not only those who are doing those things, but you, brother and sister, who are watching those things because you are having pleasure, you are being entertained by them. You are the same person. You might say you don't watch pornography. You might say you are right, you are living right.
Yeah.
But when you look at these things, when you look at men and women kissing, it's potential pornography. And from there, even if you try to go and pray, you are far away from God. This is why we have become powerless. By a simple thing. But if it was said, it's not only the television, it's the television programs. And at that time, if we have to remove the television, we'd have removed the television programs. But what happened? It came the laptops. Starting with the laptops. External hard drives. Services. Our phones. You cannot have a smartphone without that one for movies. Whether it's YouTube,
whether it's it's human or anything.
That's
and
right.
You are dripping to them and you start to be desensitized by, it started that time by only kissing.
Yeah.
And Father Abraham said, no, it not started by kissing. It started by women when they put up a little bit of their, there was a song to encourage women to put their skirts or dresses
short
on top of the knees. And it became a hit. It was desensitizing. Until now, a family drama has to be on TV with men kissing men.
Yeah.
Mm.
This is how far it has gone.
Amen.
Now, they spoke about sisters here. Make a doctrine on it. And at the end of the day, it removed the fellowship between
Amen.
Brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
Some
yes.
they say those ones, they make their hair.
Yeah.
So they fall in. Those ones who are making their hair, they say those ones, they do not have revelation. But the pastors are there. Why don't they address? Is it something which can be used that a brother and a brother cannot fellowship because of a hair? What does the scripture say? Why don't you go to the Bible and read it yourself? But you are having all these divisions for what? You are leading people astray. And it's not a matter of saying, no, we didn't know and what. Now, since you know, what are you saying? Now, since you know, people feel even ashamed, those who have got sisters with hair, because they know they will be condemned. They cannot fellowship with this one because they are seen as if they are they're fallen. And even this one, they even see, ah, this one do not have revelation.
Sure.
But what does the scripture say? These are your additions. These are your teaching for doctrines, the commandments of men.
Yeah.
You have got bishops now. I'm talking about believers. Bishops were saying they were not supposed to be there. Bishops are general overseers. When you look at those ones organizing with bishops. But you have got pastors who have created camps.
Sure.
It's part of being a bishop. They have got other, yes, they go and do evangelism in those other places. What happens when there is a pastor's day? They have to report to this one. It's like whatever they have to preach has to be aligned with what this one says, because they are the ones who came to that. What is that? We have created micro denominations.
Sure.
Micro denominations is say only our assembly is right, all the other assemblies are wrong.
Yo.
Is that the scripture?
No,
that only you?
No.
They have created also macro denominations, which are camps. Instead of having sister churches, they group. Instead of having everyone to say, who believe in this scripture, whoever believe that Jesus is Christ, is a brother and a sister, whoever believe that Brother Branham is the seventh angel, is a what? Is a brother and sister. But they've gone deep down into doctrines, their own doctrines, and they've created camps. And listen to broken systems. And you hear and going beyond beyond the camp. And as brothers and sisters, you have to go beyond these camps. If you are a brother and a sister and you are at an assembly which say they are the right, yes, be there, but just know it is wrong. It's part of the bonds which you need to throw away.
Amen.
If they are camps and they say us and them, and we believe this message,
come on,
just
now.
Throw it away. It's not scriptural.
Amen.
And it's one of the things which is going to make you miss the rapture, whether you are alive or you are dead. They've come with apostolic successions and pastoral successions, which is apostolic succession was Catholic. Pastoral succession is for message churches.
Yeah.
They put in line, I have to say it, their children for succession. How different is it from apostolic succession of Roman Catholic? When you know that this church, you're putting in line towards your favorite brother, towards your child, towards your cousin. What is that? It's the same as apostolic succession. It's not in the word.
That's right.
Amen.
Let's go to quote number 3. It says here, we have to talk about money in the church.
Oh.
About paying.
Oh.
They are paid preachers. It's in the seventh church ages. Paid assistants, paid ministers of music and education, paid choir, paid custodian programs and entertainment, and all costing great sums. But for all that, the power is decreasing. So now, paid preachers, for a preacher to come and preach, he has to be paid.
Sure.
Is that scripture?
No.
It's a mark.
Preacher.
For a pastor, for a preacher to come, he has to be said, no, I've been paid this much by this congregation to preach in this. For musicians to play, they have to be paid. It is wrong. For assistants, if there are musicians in the church, it's nothing wrong in assisting them financially. Mm. But it should not be that when they play, they are paid. Mm. If you're assisting them financially, whether that whole month they didn't play, you are just supposed to pay them. Don't link their playing and the money which you pay them. It's there in the scriptures.
Amen.
Paid choirs and custodians. Mm. It's not supposed to be like that. Mm. But the power is decreasing. Look at the assemblies whereby that is. There is no that real power. There's that one of just like chickens to drop here and there. Because of the other people in need. Because of the believers in need. Not because of the church as it stands. Yes, there would be a sister and a brother who need help, who need job, who need to be prayed for. Yes, they come. But the church on its own, if you look at it, it has lost the power.
Hey.
We're just waiting for those brothers and sisters to come with their problem. But we're not even going out there to spread the word.
Amen.
The power is decreased.
Mm.
Yes, the church is rich, but the power is not there.
True.
God moves by his spirit, not by the amount of money or talent in the church.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory. Yep.
Amen.
Let's go to quote number 4. It says here, and I just take a salary. Now, I have to address this one. I just take a salary of about $73 a week when they take out things that I have to be taken out of taxes and so forth a week. Now, it has been misquoted that all the money is in the church belongs to him, to the pastor. But here, Brother Branham, he might have said, if you go and look at that, what was he addressing? Here he's saying he's taking what? A salary. But you have seen that there are those pastors who have, because their interest in the church is financial.
Mm.
Look at it as an example. Why is it that they've got so much financial interest? A church has got 1,000 people, and let's just say 20% of them earn 20,000, and 10% of 20,000 is what? It's 2,000 times 100. It's how much a month? They're even making more profit than a company. So their interest have moved now to say, which is 200,000, which they are getting a month. And if there is more than others who earn 30, 40, 50, it's the amount even go higher. Just take 10% of the 1,000 people if they are earning 20,000. So their interest, when you look at it there, has become money. That is why they have to put pastoral succession. Because when they look at this, they're saying, I cannot lose this. It has to be come to my child. And they start, how do they make their children be pastors? How do they make their favorite person to be a pastor? Because they want to safeguard that.
Mm-hmm.
Brother Branham here is saying, I don't touch it. He's saying, and all the rest of the money goes into the gospel work alone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't touch it. Never, none of it. The church just give me a check, and that's how we live. We have big family, and you know what? You don't live a very, very expensive or very high on sick calls and everything else. And then it's $73. So it's $100 less tax. It's in 73 what it takes. He even pays tax on that money which he gets. Now, when you look into this, he's saying we don't live expensive. Look at the houses which they have made. Look at the holidays. They have to go. There's nothing wrong with going for holiday. Every man needs to rest. But there is a certain level whereby when you look, it has to be a balance. You have to show you are a man of God. So I have to say this because, but these are some of the things. As long as we can see them, it means they are amongst us as believers.
Amen.
Is it not happening? Because it has shown, it has gone back to show how their interest is. They appoint loyalists to them and not men who stand by the word. So the brothers who stand by the word in those congregations, they are not given time to preach.
Yeah.
The brothers who stand for the word, they are just removed there and they are not being put in the line of pastoral succession.
Mm-hmm.
They are put aside. Yeah. And the favorites who just come and preach alone, and you can see them. When they come here, they always say, isn't it pastor? They first have to raise the pastor. They will want to refer to their relationship with the pastor. Is it the word of God?
Oh, no.
They have got strange and biblical doctrines. Let's go to 2 Timothy 2, verse 14 to 16. I'm sorry I have to say this. This is not what I intended to preach, but as I was putting in the notes, I was directed to this. Hey, I've put something which I wanted to preach, which I've been thinking on for a very long time. But when I sat down, this just came to me. And I hope it's going to edify the
people. Amen.
Everyone. 2 Timothy 2, verse 14 to 16. He's saying, of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord, that they strive not about words to no profit. So there are some words which have no profit to the believers, but to the subverting of the hearers. So what they say is to make another brother and a sister feel less than the pastor, less than the deacon, less than the preacher. It's saying it's for subverting to have people who follow them.
Yeah.
If ever you are afraid of a pastor, there's something wrong.
Come on.
The word has to give you fear.
Amen.
The word has to give you fear,
preacher,
not fear.
Amen.
If you are afraid of the church, of this and that, more than you are afraid of Jesus Christ and of sinning, then there's something wrong.
Amen.
You're not supposed to be afraid of a pastor.
Amen.
When you see that there's that fear, ask yourself and go and pray. It's the Holy Ghost which is telling you something. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So even the preachers, they have to divide the word of God in truth, rightly divide it, because it's the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings. Profane is those things which are good to say, but they have got nothing to do with your worship. They have nothing to do with the sin, but they have got a lot of profane teachings. Let me give you one of them. They preach about lobola. About lobola, whether you pay or you don't pay, it's not a sin.
Amen.
It's a different custom and traditions from where you come from.
Amen. Amen.
So it's not a doctrine. It's not there for Isaac to get a Rebecca.
Come on now.
Did they not pay something? For even Christ to redeem the bride. Did you not pay something? Right.
Amen.
We've got the issue about wedding veils. A sister with the wrong priest, they say when it comes for her to on a wedding day, she's not supposed to wear a wedding veil. And they are doing it in this time. Why is it biblical? Let's go back. It is a tradition which was started in UK by the Queen.
Amen.
White wedding has nothing to do with the scripture, whether you're a believer or an unbeliever. It's a tradition and a culture which originated in Britain. Now they say, don't do these things according to your customs as an African, as a Tsonga, as a Pedi, as a Zulu, as a Shona, as a Shangani. They say, don't do this. Because they want a white wedding. When you do things according to your customs and tradition, because we live as a society, they see it as wrong. But they are doing another person's what? If colonization had not come here, were you going to have a white wedding? So it came by men, it did not come by God.
Amen.
Now, societal customs. They try to remove, there is a mamazala and mkwenyam. There is a mother-in-law and a son-in-law. There's a sacred relationship which is there. They try to remove it. Why? Because they're taking another tradition. And they even take time to preach that a man now end up not having respect when they meet an old man in the street. They end up not having to know that you have to stand up for an old man, or you have to stay, you have to help an elderly lady, because it is the custom. It has nothing to do with that. But they say it's a tradition and they put it away. What is it that they are doing? They're emphasizing on the pulpit about Western cultures. And when you do such things, they look at them as that. And every time, they have to repeat those same things. If you read in Brother Branham in the Church Ages, he said those people with those strange doctrines, they will preach them day after day after day. It started as a saying and end up as a, as a doctrine. Today, paying global is now a doctrine.
Yeah.
Come on now.
But is it true? Is it scriptural?
No.
Is it in the courts? So why are you making it a doctrine? Do not add nor subtract.
Amen. Amen.
Otherwise, you are adding your torment, and you are subtracting your name out of there.
Yeah.
Now, in Revelations 18 verse 4, it says, but this has become iniquities as well in us, and they are going to reach where? Heaven. If you go to Revelations, I'm not going to read, but for reference, Revelations 18, verse 4 to 5, you're going to see that these iniquities will reach God. Because instead of taking people who are coming to church to listen to the word of God, you are busy with the traditions and customs of your own suggestions and ideas of what you think it is right. If it's an advice, let it come somewhere else.
Amen.
Not
Amen.
On the pulpit.
Amen.
And these are blemishes, these are wrinkles, and these are spots. And a bride is not supposed to have any one of
Amen.
Them. These blemishes,
Amen.
These wrinkles, and these spots. And in Mark 13, we hear that there is an abomination. Let's go to Mark 13 from verse 14 to 16.
Amen.
But when you shall see the abomination of dissolution spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing where it ought not, let him that read it understand. Then let them that be in Judea flee to the mountains. And let him that is on the housetop not go inside. So when you shall see these brothers and sisters, some of these things which I've said here, when you shall see them, flee, because it's part of what? It's part of an abomination. And today, our abomination, we stand in, it's a denomination.
That's right.
So, anything which has to align itself with a denomination, whether it's micro, whether it's macro, whether it's wrong doctrine, because when they come with these doctrines of logola, of weddings, when they come with these doctrines of TV, they see someone without a TV, someone with a TV as someone who's wrong.
Yeah.
But it's not scriptural. What happens? When you see it, you have to run. And when you are running, when I'm saying running, I'm not saying leave this congregation and go to this congregation.
Yeah.
No, run to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's
Amen.
Not about following this brother
Amen.
Or this assembly, but you should run to Jesus Christ, and he's going to direct you
Amen.
Where you're supposed to
yes.
be.
Amen.
Now, let's look at today as I wind up. Let's look at today. It's later than you think, brothers. Let's not be deceived. And let us look at this, because they say if it was possible, it could even deceive
the very elect.
The very elect. So do not be deceived. And how is a message believer deceived? He's deceived by a message preacher.
Yes.
He's deceived in the message church. Because that is where he goes. Now, look at the world now. I just want to look at the current events to show you that things have even gone worse. Look at Biden election. We've spoken about it. You can even relate it to what has been said in the Bible. It's the second Catholic president. What does it mean? You have to look into that. There is censorship on Twitter, on Facebook. They are censoring anyone who opposes their thinking. What is that we're told about communism? Isn't that communism? And Brother Branham said, in them trying to have or to vote for socialism, they brought in communism. The reason why I have to focus on America, because it's the one in Revelation 13. So whatever happens there, it's a good clock which tells the time of what is happening world over. And America always leads. So even from its election, Brother Branham will always look and comment into that. So you can see that communism is there. They say people have got rights, but they end up to show you that these people, they don't care, and they are so powerful than what we can see. Look at the president of the United States.
Come on now.
Was censored. To say, and because of some of the things which they have seen or which they have said, they want to take him to impeach him. What about you and me and those and other brothers who are going to be standing and preaching this way? They are censoring. There's a lady who was just removed, who was promoting for a family. So they said, the way you are talking about family, you are not including, or you are going against the homosexuals.
Hey.
You are being homophobic.
Hey.
They removed her from Twitter and Facebook. Censorship. What is censorship? Communism. What is Brother Branham saying about communism? And where it operates, it shows that there is Romanism, and the purple curtain is rising.
Amen.
So when you look at that, remember, we're talking about a communism. Just look at how they are controlled, because communism, they control what is it that you hear, and they push propaganda. Propaganda is only one-sided. Look at it even here in South Africa, the Zondo Commission is only talking about specific people and hiding specific people. You have to be foolish to see that that thing is useless. But it is communism even in these nations. Look at Zimbabwe, look at Uganda. It's just communism. They control, you cannot have, you have got freedom of speech, but you don't have freedom after the speech. So, this is communism if you cannot see it. Right? You have got, Brother Branham spoke about Romanism. If you go at the definition of Romanism, what is it? Romanism, it's a democratic party in America. If you go on Wikipedia, it refers you. So who's there and who's pushing that agenda of what? Of these whole bad things. It is the Democrats, which is the other horn of the lamp, and the other horn is a Republican. So they always push, the other one push for civil rights. You can look at the civil rights sodomites are there in the White House. He has appointed them, but it did not start with Biden.
No.
It started mainly with Obama. If you look at it at his speech, he spoke about that when I switched off from him. And they always tell you the civil rights. No, he's an African. No, he's like this. But they do not show you that it's just a camouflage. Now, Obama started with abortions. Now they're putting back abortion. Why is it that they push abortions? They don't talk about that. It's a sin.
Yeah.
For that woman to be pregnant with a man who's not their husband. And it's killing abortion. Why is it that they don't talk about it? Because look in the Bible. It's sacrifice of children. Have they not done it before? Sacrificing children? For what? For their own rituals. Why are they sacrificing? I don't know whether it's true or false, but I've heard about that. The embryos of something is to make vaccines. That's why they push for that. Because they want those children, but they don't tell you if you go and research about it. There's the big pharma mafia. What are they doing about this? That's to show you that the world is going and to that place of you being squeezed out to the squeeze. All these countries are encouraged for them to take this vaccine for coronavirus. But in months ago, there is a country called Madagascar. It came with something when they said it works.
Yeah.
Why is it that they did not support it?
No.
They want everyone, each and every nation, for it to be owing them money. Mm-hmm. And when you owe them money as a government, even your worship, even whatever your governance, has to be controlled by them.
Yeah.
That's why you see they are pushing each and every country for this vaccination. It's not like they want and support that. This is where we are, brothers and sisters. I'm just highlighting some of these things on the world condition. And as you see these things, just know that it's time for the great escape.
Amen.
We have to escape these conditions. We have to escape what is happening now. Amen. Look at Brother Barry told us it will be time of the squeeze. It will be time of the press. And it's the time of the paid pool, brothers and sisters. Let's move into Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let's put away all this filth in our lives.
Amen.
Let's put away the wrong doctrines. Amen. Let's just start to walk with Christ alone.
Amen.
As brothers and sisters, wherever you are, wherever they follow the brother and the sister, just love them. Whether they are in sin, whether they are not in sin, whether they are believers and not believers, just love them. Because God said he even brings the rain to those even who are evil.
Amen.
Even yourself, bring the rain of love. But I'm not saying love their sins. I'm saying love them.
Amen.
Do not discriminate against them.
Amen.
Even at work, even at school.
Amen.
Just treat them fairly. Whether they are believers or not believers.
Amen.
Don't have favoritism. If you have to do something, even if it's a gay person, it's at work, you're in the environment, in the space of the devil, just do it. Even if it's a woman wearing a trousers or a miniskirt, just do what you have to do. Because in them seeing you,
Amen.
They are going to see something. You are going to be that epistle which can preach to them.
Amen.
If you are fighting and discriminating them, you are not doing something which Christ did.
Mm.
Christ never said he's not going to talk with the publicans
Mm-mm.
or scribes or Pharisees. He spoke with all of them.
Amen.
He gave them that. Let's leave it to God to
Hallelujah.
Judge. But where you are in this message, not in the message church. I'm talking about
Amen.
This message.
Come on now.
Amen.
It is a message. It cannot be changed. It cannot denominate.
Amen.
Be in the bride to escape these things which are coming. Be prayerful whether you have got money or
Amen.
No money. It's
Amen.
Not a doctrine.
Amen.
Whether your clothes match or they don't match, it's not a doctrine.
Amen.
So let's not look at it. And to the brothers who are in need, sisters who are in need, let's just pray. It does not mean that God doesn't love you.
Yes.
If your finances are not going to be enough. For sure, the finances are not going to be enough. Because why? Everything is contracting. There's no country whose economy is growing.
Yes.
Everything is going down. Amen. Everything is rotting. As you can see with the scripture, escape the seventh vision, whereby Brother Branham looked and saw that what had happened. If this is the second, if this is the sixth vision, which had happened, now there is the seventh vision. We are left with a small gap, and we don't know how long it's going to be. So please, brothers and sisters, just look into that. Don't be left out. In Jesus Christ,
amen.
I think you have been blessed.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Let's just pray as we finish. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, Jesus, for this time that we have had with the brothers and the sisters,
yes, Lord,
in this fellowship. May you bless each and every one of them, those who are here and those who are on the network and those who are going to watch later.
Yes, Lord.
If ever there is anyone with a need, Lord, may you touch,
yes, Lord,
them,
amen,
Lord.
Amen.
It might be about their life, about their family. It might be about finances that they are not balancing. Lord, touch them.
Yes,
Lord. This world, Lord, is not being merciful. As we can see, high unemployment rates.
Yes.
It means people do not have enough money. They do not have enough food. They do not even have money for medicine.
Yes.
But Lord, we know that you healeth each and every disease.
Hallelujah.
If ever there is a brother and a sister who is in need because they are sick and they do not have money, Lord, for them to go to hospital, they should know that this world,
yes,
it is the only and thing which can help them in, yes, this time.
Yes.
Amen.
The medicines come from what you have created.
Amen.
And what you have created came from what you have said.
Amen.
Be with,
amen,
them. And if ever there's a brother and a sister who are going through financial difficulties, brother, Lord, may you help them.
Yes.
May you touch them.
Yes.
May that little which they have, may you make it enough.
Amen.
And may you look, Lord, and guide them. And every brother and sister who are in need of anything, Lord, including myself, Lord, may you help us, Lord. May,
yes,
you guide us. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.